What's up, guys? Welcome to today's video. Guys, today we're bringing you another Inside the Mind gameplay. These are probably my favorite videos to make, as I think they're actually the most helpful. What we basically do with the In the Mind gameplay is we just come on MUT and we play a gameplay here for you, and we just kind of talk about what's going on in the game is really the whole premise behind it. So we're starting out here, and what we like to do is come out in this big dime 146, and what I really, really like to do here is play pretty much exclusive on the first drive, two man under. And the reason we go with that, the reason I think that it's so important to play that defense opening up, is because, in my opinion, two man under is the hardest defense to beat as is, to beat stock. And basically the key here is to ask your opponent one question: can you beat two man under? Because two man under has a couple of reasons why it's good. First and foremost, it's man coverage. But secondly, and more importantly, is you have two deep safeties. This two deep safety shell, along with the man coverage, is going to mean that anytime they go deep, you're going to have two players in the area to make a play on the ball. So it really helps you against those deep streaks. And that's probably, that's really why we like it so much. Starting out here, can you run on this D? Yeah, you can run on it. Honestly, you can. I'm actually okay with you running on it, and here's why. Because most running teams, most running offenses, you can actually do fairly decent against them if you just are running basic user skill. Is really what you need to stop most running attacks, for my money, in this year's game. So, here you're going to see the base for the whole thing is this two-man. As you see, it's just very hard to beat. The real thing you have to watch out for is scrambling quarterbacks, and that's why we use a spy and a flat zone. If they're right-handed, we normally flat zone this backer on the right side. If they're left-handed, we flat zone the other backer. Occasionally, we'll get some A-gap pressure with this setup, too. If you want this setup, what you're going to need to do is you're going to need to get on our offensive and defensive guides when they come out and after Thanksgiving. To start, I would actually get this other one. It's actually fairly inexpensive. Not maybe the luckiest catch I've seen, but it's actually fairly inexpensive. You can get them in the description. They're only like $10 a piece, which compared to most guys, it's pretty cheap. But yeah, looks like he's rocking. I think this is probably the team MVP, Andy Dalton. I've been playing guys with a lot better teams than me. Couldn't get the play set up. There, almost got another interception. Skandrick. But yeah, I mean, first drive, normally we start out with this. Because what it's going to do is it's going to establish, hey, we're not going to give up deep streaks really at any cost. We're trying not to give up deep streaks. And here you see, there he goes deep. And we have two players in the area. So 3rd and 10. Very sweet. Some just basic pressure. I'm finding this play actually gets really good pressure, and you only are blitzing one player. But the thing is, like, if they roll out, you can click your right stick in, and it's going to get them to blitz off that spy. The other thing that's really good about it is occasionally you'll get some A-gap pressure. And so it's really, really good. So make sure you check out our guide for the setup to this. But it has great coverage. And in my opinion, it's not a play that we want to run. Like, if it's like 3rd and 2 from like the 15-yard line, we're going to get into that 3-3-5 odd and really, you know, kind of get really in your face. But what... what this defense forces you to do is it forces you to drive. And not very many defenses in this year's game protect against that like this one does. And so that's really really the heart as to why we run it. Starting out here, the offense is the same as it's been. And we're just going to look to run the snugs on this guy. I really am so excited to share the snugs, because I think it's just such a breakthrough for the offensive side of the ball this year. It's going to really help you beat two-man under, which is most people's favorite. I mean, it's my favorite defense, too, and this is going to help you consistently beat it, really for pretty big gains. There you see us starting off here. Have had a couple of really bad losses, last-second heroics and things lately, so trying to get back on the winning side of things. And I really, really like this offense. I'm just going to tell you, just throw that out there right off the start. Just because I think it just does such a good job at beating man. There you see another man beater. If they want any chance at beating you when you're running the snugs, they have to play as home. And what it's going to do then is it's going to open up some opportunities for other things that you can do. But if they're just going to play man, you're going to hit them with this route to Keenan Allen all game long. I cannot stress enough how effective this route really becomes when you have a guy like Keenan Allen running it with that high route running. Here he goes, zone. We're able to hit Macklin in the seams. I'm actually really liking this Jeremy Macklin card. I picked him up. I actually stayed away from him for most of the season, and I've gone back and really reevaluated and actually ended up picking him up, and he's haven't looked back. And here you see the offense just dotting 6 for 6. I find Tony Romo is probably the best quarterback because he's the most accurate. I just can't deal with bad throws, and even Tony Romo, with 98 throw accuracy and like 96, I think it's like 94, 95, and 93 or something. Just crazy accuracy stats. I even find him missing easy throws. So it really infuriates me, but I don't really know, because you know that guys like Matt Ryan or some of those guys that I've had in the past like are not able to make those throws. So Tony Romo for me is the only option. He's not that expensive for as far as talking like the best throwing accuracy quarterback. He's 28,000 coins. And I think that's a little bit more than normal. I think I paid 30,000. But here's his stats. He's got 94 throwing power. He's got 94 deep throw accuracy, 93 short throw accuracy, and 92 middle throw accuracy. Another guy that you might consider, I don't know what the frick happened, but we lost all of our play clock. Another guy that you might look into, I know most elite players have him, and I've actually tried him out and ended up selling him recently, is John Elway. Now let me read you his stats. He's about 100,000 coins, give or take about 30K. But he has 93 short throw, 92 mid throw. So they're the same as Tony Romo's. He has 96 throwing power, which is 2 higher than Tony Romo's. And then he has 95 deep throw accuracy, which is 1 higher than Tony Romo's. And I'm finding that really, it's not enough difference for the coins. And honestly, for me, John Elway misses more throws than Tony Romo. Sometimes I think throwing power in this year's game actually causes an issue. If your guy has too much throwing power, then you can actually see some issue with that. Now Elway does have a little bit more mobility with his 76 speed. I know Romo's speed is not that high, but another thing that we're finding here is this Team of the Week Drew Brees card. He's going for about 120,000 coins. I don't know why it's running so much time off the clock, but dang it, I didn't get to. It's too busy talking. But Drew Brees' Team of the Week card has better short and medium throw accuracy than Tony Romo, but his deep throw suffers by 3 points. So Brees has 91 throw power, which is 3 fewer than Tony Romo. He has 91 deep throw accuracy, which is 3 fewer than Tony Romo. 95 short throw and 94 middle throw, those are actually higher. His middle throw is both are 2 points higher than Tony Romo's. So I don't really know, to be 100% honest, should I go with Drew Brees or should I go with Tony Romo? Is the middle accuracy and short accuracy more important than the deep accuracy, or are they equal importance and I should just, you know, go with who I've got? So, you know, definitely some debate, some opportunity for that. And so let me know what you guys think. I haven't quite made up my mind for what I'm going to do here. So the key also, real quick, for the Dime 146, one of the keys to it, if you're not blitzing, if you're just going to run the cover 2 man, is to not pass commit. If you pass commit, your guys will get blocked, like literally blocked. Like, it's crazy how easy it is to block these guys if you pass commit. But if you don't pass commit, they won't be blocked as easily. You actually have a little bit, it's not as bad. And here we give up a touchdown run. So I say it's not as bad as we give up a huge run to CJ Spiller, miss a tackle. But honestly, guys, that's a rarity. You won't see that a ton. And it kind of goes back to, am I willing to let them run the ball on me for 5 to 10, occasionally break one? Or am I willing to get moss deep, you know, like by guys who only run 4 verticals? And I can't quite decide. I think it's a mix of the two, and honestly, the perfect middle ground might be the 4-3 under, because you can run pressure from the 4-3 under at a 2-man under coverage. The problem with it is that the 2-man under coverage is not as good because they're, first of all, they're linebackers, and second of all, the deep middle coverage is not as strong, really, and it's just not as balanced of a formation. We talk run defense. It's 4-3 personnel, but they're in very bad positions to stop, like, quick pitches and runs to the left side of the formation. So with all that in mind, I normally will probably stick with this Dime 146 just because it really puts you in a good position. But definitely still going back and forth. Here he sent some screamers at me. Ends up getting some good pressure. I think he ran the same pressure I've actually run out of the 146. It's just a different formation. I thought he was in man. He was in zone. Good play by him. Honestly, you know, we just didn't get the ball out of our hands quick enough. There's Bush. So this situation, 3rd and 8, we've got to really lock in here. We need a big first down. He's probably going to send some pressure. We're going to go to a little money play. It's really, really good. It's going to get you about 8 yards a pop. We're able to hit Julian Edelman on that out route. So good play there. Here we're going to try to see if he'll go back to 2-man because he hasn't had such success with that blitz. He sends pressure here off that left side, so we need to know that. Send some heavy pressure. We're able to get a nice touch pass. The beauty of this offense is that not only do you get open players, is another thing that's really good about it is there's so many floods, and the key to that is it's going to give you yards after the catch. When you talk about the ability to use, you know, multiple players going in multiple directions, and that zone of seams play really does a good job for getting yards after the catch. It really does a nice job for us. So here he goes, man. There's Jeremy Maclin making a huge catch for me. I think we actually threw it a little bit early and didn't quite take all the principles for clearing out the zones that we should have. There's Bush. And he's running a lot of heavy pressure plays and it really kind of forces me to take a different approach to beating him. There's a nice throw to Julian Edelman, and you see the offense really, really starting to come full circle here. As it's it's forcing him to play man because he can't blitz me, but he can't play man because the guys are just the concepts, the route progressions are very effective against man. There's that little drag. So a little chess match going on here. Sends that heavy pressure blitz. And I figured that he was going to send that pressure. There's a nice play by Emmanuel Sanders. I figured the heavy pressure was coming because of his corner alignment. Here I like doing this. I like motioning Cooks out. And seeing if I can slip this into McKinnon. I'm actually going to roll out with Romo. I do like that as well, especially a short yardage like that. It's a nice. It's basically a flood in terms of spacing. It's a short horizontal flood across the formation. And normally we'll go, and I actually talked about this. It's really, really good to get into this single back bunch ace and even this inside zone that we're going to run right here. As far as... a situation. McKinnon didn't explode, but a situation where your short yardage, where you need like a yard. I'm finding it's probably best in this year's game to run the ball. To run the ball, specific runs like inside zones, quick pitches, fullback dives, that kind of thing. If you're going to pass, I find it most effective to have flood plays like you saw. So here, play action, wheel, and there's Jason Barrett. Guys, if you don't have Jason Barrett, if you're on a budget and you don't have Jason Barrett, I highly recommend him. In my opinion, he's the best budget corner in the game. He just does a really, really good job for the amount of coins he costs. There's Edelman. And I just, honestly, in this situation, I don't know really. I shouldn't have called that timeout. Really should have just taken it into halftime because of the score. But I'm hoping to maybe catch him doing something here. So we're going to go zone of seams. We're going to fade Sanders, and then we're going to streak Reginald Bush, bring him to the left. If he's in cover two, there should be something. And it's just a basic man, so we'll take the check down out route. We got 1 second. Keep Romo in the game. And let's see here if we can't make something happen. Off this left side. We don't really do this much. This is just something we're trying. And this crossing pattern was wide open, so we have to take that and just go into half. We're 17-17 for 202. Not too shabby offensively so far. So, like I said, guys, this offense is going to come out. It's coming out the day after Thanksgiving. Or not the day of Thanksgiving, but the week. That Monday is what I'm going to shoot for. Or maybe not that Monday, maybe that Tuesday. But somewhere in there, we're going to try to release the guide. And obviously, just stay posted to the channel. If you guys haven't subscribed, be sure to subscribe because we have some free content as well, some free tips, some free plays on our channel. The foundation for this offense, you can check that out below. It's already available for purchase. And it talks about the zone of post and some of the other ways we've used this formation. So definitely have some options out there for you if you're looking to get better. But yeah. And there he goes, heavy cover zero pressure. One of the things that screams to me when they go like that, cover zero pressure like that, is to potentially, is to try to make a pay here with zone of seams. I actually had to make some adjustments to this play. Take a check down. So right there, it's something I've been trying, and it wasn't a good look for it. So we ended up checking down. And this is where Reggie Bush can really make his money on the seam. If they go cover zero, and they do, we're just going to take this out route, though. And that's the thing. Sometimes, guys, it's important to get the ball out of your hands. You know, as you see, I mean, I think the theme, if there's a theme to this offense, it's that we get the ball out of our hands really, really quickly. And we have quick reads. And there's that wheel against that cover two man. Zone a post up. Throw the high pass lead there, get the ball out. So, I mean, you're just seeing, if you want to know how to beat man coverage, this is a perfect example of someone playing heavy man coverage, and you just can't do it against this offense. Romo's 20... I think he's 21 for 21 or something like that. He's a perfect passing right now from Romo. And they're just open. You know, they're just open. And against most defenses, people that play man, most offenses have a hard time getting open. And so if there's one thing we want to stress, it's that the ability to get open against that two-man under coverage that so many people are running. I'm actually starting to go away from Jerick McKinnon, because of what you just saw. That acceleration, that burst is not quite there for him. It's unfortunate. I really like everything else he brings to the table. His agility is phenomenal. But Dre Archer just has that explosive speed to get to the edge. And we're using the most feared Dre Archer because he has 97 speed. I think the base Dre Archer only has 96. It's 10,000 coins of a difference, so I don't know if it's worth it or not. But we had the coins we were able to spend on him, and if we don't like it, we can always sell him. The thing is that he can just explode in that middle ground where we need him to. As far as passing, we can pass from the bunch ace. It's just a matter of we don't really need to right now. He hasn't shown that he can stop the run to me consistently enough that we would say, okay, we really need to pass the ball. I feel like he's got to show us a little more in his run defense before we're going to be willing to get out of that. So defensively, we'll see how we fare with this 3-3-5 odd. Like I said, it's just so good against the run because there's so many people in the line of scrimmage. And they're all like linebackers or linemen or safeties. Or, you know, the theme for the 3-3-5 is zone. Is zone, heavy zone. So it goes play action. There's pressure. I think that was Kirksey. He's got Odell Beckham Jr. on that outside. Going on, there's that, and there we are. And there you see, if they don't throw streaks, that's best. It's hands down, the nickel 3-3-5 odd is the best, absolute best defense in the game. If they throw streaks, which most people do throw streaks, it changed it a little bit. And there's a good 2 men under is hard to beat, and especially in a 4th and 21. It's very hard to beat. So the offense will come back out here, see what they can muster up. If we score here, he'll probably concede defeat. So offensively, it's a big drive. Got to get 6 points here. Does us no good. Absolutely no good here to get less than 6. Goes man, we're able to hit Bush. Got a block. Yeah, we're 24 for 24, so pretty good. Pretty good precision right now for the offense. I mean, Romo's played really well for me today. So I think he may have earned a spot to stay with us as opposed to switching. I was really considering to switch to Breeze. I did switch to Elway for a little bit. Elway didn't have it for me. But, yeah. See if he goes back to man. We'll hit that out route, and Edelman will make the catch. The other thing about this, too, is all of my receivers have good catching traffic as well. I look for that, too. It's not just route running. It's route running plus catching traffic. In my opinion, those are the ratings you need to be looking for. And, yeah. Here's Dre Archer. And we didn't get a block. Didn't get a good block. I'm considering, for this short kick, actually putting a guy in with very bad kick power and very good kick accuracy. And I'm actually going to look at that on Mutthead. If you guys aren't on Mutthead, that's tip number one. You get on Mutthead.com if you're playing Mutt. It's a very good resource. But the best kick accuracy guy in the game is this guy named Drew Butler. He's got 96 kicking accuracy. And I'm considering it because I don't really need him to kick it far. I simply need him to kick it in the position I want it kicked in. His kick power is only 86, you see. And so that may be something that there to that. Johnny Hecker is the most more expensive kicker. He's like 47,000 coins, and his kick accuracy is 95. His kick power is 95. In my opinion, not worth that much coinage. Here's some screens. There's heavy pressure. Skandrick is going to take it in for 6, and now you're starting to see this is a great game for us to get us back on track, and pretty big win for us if we can finish this one out and hold him off. Here I want to show you a couple of things from the snugs here. Try to show you some things I do if I want to score, and I'm just running a standard plays here. So one of the things we take advantage of is this route to circle in combination. So here, if he plays man, oh, he's going to go ahead and play man, and then we have this read here to the outside of Edelman. Just a standard bullet pass, no pass lead. Do not pass lead that route, just a basic bullet pass, and you're good. So, yeah. Love that short kick because it's going to set us up easy hit sticks here. You know, easy hit sticks. And here, we pretty much will play two men under the entire game. This is where you can sub in your guy, your Jelani Jenkins, your Brandon Marshalls, Christian Kirksey's, of course. And we're actually going to put some faster guys. Oh, we have this Bradley Roby card. Well, we're not going to worry about it. So we're just going to go standard. And we'll go two-man. And we weren't able to set this up. So he's rolling out in the pocket. So he's completed one pass. Well, the defense has certainly played up to par. And we've got a. This is where you feel free to pass commit. There's double coverage. You see, even Jerry Rice, even legend Jerry Rice, doesn't stand a chance against double coverage. If it's single coverage, he'll make that play all game. Remember play action. Three people in the area. So, like I said, guys, if you want to check those guys out, they're below. In my opinion, the key to defense in this year's game, and this is important, so you may want to write this down, because I really, really, truly believe that this may be the most important thing I say all season long. For me, the key to defense in this year's game is not making mental mistakes. Mental mistakes such as not having safety help over top in situations where you need safety help over top. Not pass committing against running sets. You know, the little things about the game that, you know, we just assume everybody knows. In my opinion, this year they're more important than ever. Having a quarterback spy on the field, if you're going to play coverage defense, having a quarterback spy is essential. You know, things like that. And when you're playing cover two and play a ton of two-man under, especially get really good man coverage, guys. If you have good man coverage on the field, it's very, very hard to move the ball. It really, truly is. It's so hard to beat two men under consistently in this year's game. If you can do those things, you're going to be very, very effective in this season's game. Make sure you're calling man align and press. In my opinion, that's the most important thing when playing two men under, is to man align and press. For some reason, we keep going off sides. I don't know if it's a formation that sometimes lines us up weird. Man line press. The two man under defense. Oh, if you don't want to use quarterback spies real quick, try a flat zone to the side they're going to roll out to. If they roll out right, like if they're right-handed and you just want to use a standard flat zone, normally that actually does pretty fair. Not always, but normally. You know, if they obviously they roll out to the opposite side, though, it's now a problem. And we end up getting beat over the middle. So that's the other thing. I find this year I'm getting beat more to the middle than to the outside. So, you know, try to overcompensate and use middle coverage instead of outside coverage. In my opinion, they're more important. And see here, this is a mental mistake. I'm in the wrong defense. I got bailed out by the 2-minute warning. But see, first and goal. So now that they're past that kind of ability to throw deep streaks, so past the 30-yard line, basically. Now is where we get into this D here. And try to stop quick slants, basically. Normally, you'll see a lot of quick slants. You'll see a lot of spacing. Normally is what you're going to see in this situation. And this is where we bring in, you know, heavy hitters that don't really, you don't really need much speed here. You need heavy hitters. So we have Jesse Williams in here, Kerry Wynn's in, Brian Arakpo's in, you know, those kind of guys. So it's all about personnel, where you put them on the field. And MUT, more than any mode, you can actually really tailor your formation by personnel. And there you see, good zone coverage is essential too. So we have Hayward, Ilka, and then our user player is our user player, so he doesn't need good coverage per se. There, I was hoping Gibson would come down on that. So, you know, it's been hard for him to move the ball. Yes, he just got that touchdown, but it's in crunch time. So I'm not too mad at it. Obviously, we want to be perfect, but the defense has given up two touchdowns. The offense has played perfect this game, not even thrown an incomplete pass yet. So very proud of that. And that's the other thing, guys. Always audible to onside recover. I mean, little things like that. And then when you audible to onside recover, click onto this second guy here. You want the second guy perfect. Hold L trigger so he's not going to move. So he's going to stand still. It's going to get you a clean catch. That's what you're looking for on onside recovery team, is a clean catch. Okay? So it's just very important this year to do the little things and to not make mental mistakes, to not throw interceptions, to not give up, you know, big-time sacks. Those are the things that's really going to win you ball games in this year's game for my money. So, you know, be sure that you're looking at that and really taking that into consideration as we're going through here. And you're seeing what he's doing is heavy pressure, heavy pressure, heavy pressure. And I'm just simply moving the ball. I'm not quite as concerned with hitting him deep because I don't have to be. Now, if we were in a situation where I may have to be, then obviously I would be, but I'm not in that situation, so I don't have to worry about it as much. Here you see he goes two man under. I'm able to hit that wheel route and get into the end zone. Some different concepts that I use to beat man-to-man coverage, but in my opinion, if you play man-to-man coverage, I will beat you and beat you and beat you and beat you, and I will go 28 for 28 and, you know, score, 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 because it's very, very hard to stop me with a simple two-man under in this year's game. Most people, it works well. Not so much when you use this Arizona playbook, use the snugs that we're talking about. We're going to have that in that offensive guide, and you're seeing right now the threat, the ability of the offense to score in bunches, and you're seeing it right here. Really a perfect game here for us, so definitely recommend at least checking this video out. And I really, really hope you guys have stayed with me, because I think I've thrown in some really good nuggets towards the end of the video that may help you as you continue through here. Another defense I really like is cover two sync, especially with this defense. And the reason I like it is because it's very good. It's a very good complement to the two-man under defense, because it's very similar, because you're going to get that two-man press on the outside, so you're going to get those streaks stopped. And then the other thing that you're going to be able to do is you're going to be able to, you know, kind of use her better middle coverage as a whole. And as you're seeing that, it's very difficult. In my opinion, cover two sync may be the best stock compared to two-man under. They're both very good. I kind of go back and forth with which one I like the best. But yeah. And then in solo receiver sides, the cool part about the dime 1-4-6 is you can play man, because you have the personnel on the field to do that. So So Hail Mary here. Got two men under. And it's going to get a bat down, and we're going to get the ball back. So you're seeing the kind of the basic difference in the game here is that I'm able to beat two men under, and he's not. I mean, you could boil it. It's almost as simple as that. It really truly is almost as simple as that. I'm beating two men under, and he is getting beat by two men under. You know, a really small nuance, but in my opinion, a very big difference in the game. And he's also, he's not protecting the flats. The cool part about the snugs is the flats beat both man and zone. You can beat both man and zone from the flats. So yeah, just a simple game. I mean, I think we're 28-28 for 360 yards. We'll probably show you the stats at the end of this one just to kind of recap it for you. But a really, really solid game. And it just comes down to do not make mental mistakes. Do not make mental mistakes. Do not make mental mistakes. Be able to beat two man under. And quite simply, it really is as simple as that. Don't give up kick returns. Those are little things that we don't think about as much because we just assume, oh, well, it's kick return. You know, we shouldn't. Obviously, we got to be good against that. And it's not a big time game changing concept. But in my opinion, this year, more than any other year, it is important to have good kick return defense. It's important to be able to have, you know, good defenses for situations like this where it doesn't necessarily stop their offense. It just makes it very difficult for them to drive up the field consistently. And, you know, a couple of things that you're seeing in this game is we only gave up 14 points. We really only, and we probably should have not even given up that many. But it's all about positioning in this year's game, I think. And two men under plays a big part of positioning. And you see, you're never two. The thing basically that comes down to this: with two men under, you're never out of position. Simple as that. With two men under, you are never out of position. And I honestly believe that is why it's the most important defense for you to have. And I think we forgot to spy somebody. See, and there it's a big game. You see, when you forget to do one little thing, you end up getting destroyed. There's that A-gap pressure to close the game out. So, guys, I appreciate you watching. If you guys are still around, I really appreciate it. I love doing gameplays like this, and if you like it, make sure you leave a like rating. Let me know what your favorite part of the video was. Also, if you can do me a favor, guys, make sure to check out those guides below. If you want to have a really good offense and a really good defense, check those guides out below. They're very, very effective. I want to show you real quick the stats for Tony Romo in this game. I just think it's really cool. I don't know how we did not have a perfect passer rating, but we're 28 from 28, 362 yards, no picks, two TDs, pretty good game. And then we actually held him. He had that one big run, and then outside of that, really nothing too much. We didn't really run the ball much. We never really do, but anyway, so that's what